So we've got many social networks at our disposal, and the social networks really are the best way for you to reach an audience because you've got a great website or you've got a great portfolio and you need to reach people. And so we talked about Twitter last time, and we're going to talk about another social network. This one will be Google Plus. We're also going to hit Facebook and such. We'll talk about the big three ones and a few other ones. We'll be talking about Google Plus today because Google Plus, of course, is a Google entity, Google Search, Android, all of that. It's so integrated together. So if we have a footing in Google Plus, that gives us more of an edge on the competition that is not on Google Plus, that is on Facebook only or Twitter only. So we'll be talking about setting up a Google Plus profile. I'm going to go ahead and open up my web browser, and let's go over to see this first. Let's go to google.com/plus-pmd-interactive. So here I'm just showing an example of a possible Google Plus profile. Now, Twitter's got profiles for businesses, and so does LinkedIn, and so does Facebook. They've all got a personal and a business version of the social network. And you can use social networks in those two big ways, the personal way and the professional way. And both are, of course, legitimate. These social networks are full of hundreds of millions of people willingly all day long being on Twitter, on Facebook, on Snapchat, whatever. So that's an audience there. That's the whole point of our business being on social media. There's people there, people that will really care about my product or my brand or whatever. So if I'm there, if my company is there, if I reach out to people that care about my message on these networks, I could potentially get these followers. I could potentially get sales or whatever you're trying to do online. Maybe I'm a nonprofit organization and I want to get donations. Well, I could get on Twitter, I could get on Facebook, Google Plus, Instagram, whatever, and try to find people that would be interested in my message and therefore market to them. That's the whole purpose of us using social media. So here's my company's Twitter, my company's Google Plus account. And it looks like every other social network with some variations. There's pictures, there's video, there's text, there's likes, there's replies, comments. All the networks have variations on the same thing. Sharing video, sharing links, sharing blog posts, photos, jokes, whatever. They're all to some variation about sharing. They're all to some variation also about comments. People commenting, people liking it, people sharing it. All the networks are like that. When you did the Twitter assignment, you needed to tweet something every day, and you needed to follow accounts, and then some would follow you. You'd build an audience. We need to do very, very similar things. It's not going to be such an intense assignment for Google Plus, but we will create an account here, we will use it, and I'll guide you toward what I feel are the most effective ways to use Google Plus. We talked about Twitter and about hashtags a little here and there, and keywords and searching and such. And Google Plus has the same thing. You can put hashtags, you can search, but I'm going to show you basically that Google Plus has two things that are really cool for you to reach an audience: collections and communities. Before we get to that, we need to create an account. Now, how many of you currently have a Gmail email account? Okay, most of us. So we're going to use that Gmail to activate the Google Plus account. And
you know what? I have Google Plus, but I have no idea how to use it.
Well, that's what we're going to be talking about, definitely, because all of these
I get
networks.
messages from them and all this stuff. I'm like, where's this coming from?
You can probably get a couple different messages, either one that's like updates or
Yeah.
one that's like, here's how to use it. So yeah, you might get different messages and such. And I would look into them. I would click and read them and see what they're about, because they could be useful. But we'll talk about it. We'll talk about it in a moment, how to best use Google Plus for business. The thing about Google Plus, again, is we can use it for personal, we can use it for business. And we want to create a business account. So here's what we'll do. On the top right corner, you should see the sign in button. Go ahead and click sign in. And here's the decision you have to make early on. It's going to ask you for an email. Now, you can use your personal email to then create the business account. That's fine. That's what I do. You could use a business email to create the business account. That's another way to do it. I'm going to recommend just use your personal email address, and then we will create the business one. And your personal info will not be linked to your business account. That's okay. In my company, we manage Google Plus and Twitter and so forth for a variety of companies. But our personal information is not tied up with the Google Plus business account. So take a moment to sign in with your Gmail. And I can't show you exactly that screen because mine's already set up and it's very cumbersome for me to create a brand new one. So what you should do is just sign in, and let me look over your shoulder. Just sign in till you get to like the main screen, and then we'll take it from there. So basically, we're going to sign in as personal, and it might ask you about connecting with your friends and family and such. Don't worry about that yet at the moment. It's going to ask you about your birthday and your high school and all that. Don't worry about putting any of that in. You just want to log in, get an account, and then I'll show you what we're going to focus on. We're going to focus on the business one. So don't worry about filling any of that info in. We just need to create it as a person, and then we'll create business accounts. So let me log into mine, and then we'll see what we need to do. All right, so if you've managed to log in, most likely it took you to a personal account. And Google makes a distinction between a personal account and a business account. The terminology is a little bit, I wish they would use better terms, but there's the personal profile, and then there's the business page. And I mix up the two all the time. Profile and page, there's just such generic terms. But profile is personal, and page is for business. And on mine, because I've already set this up, mine's personal, because there's my picture. Yours might have a picture also at the top right, or it may not. That's okay. But I'm going to show you here. I've got the personal account, and in my particular case, if you look here for a moment, if I click on my name, it shows here, okay, go off and manage these different pages. Go off and manage these different companies. So this business and that business and this business. So me as a person, I have access to all of these pages, but my personal info does not show up in any of these. So that's why sometimes people are wary. They're like, okay, should I use my personal Gmail or should I create a brand new business Gmail? It doesn't matter, but just to make it easiest, use your personal one, and then you can create as many business pages as you want. Look at how I do that on my personal one, because I work with different clients. They're all listed there. For yourself, you're probably just going to have your one business page. We'll see how to do that right now. Everything else that you hear, just ignore it and go up to the address business.google.com. This is the business portal over on Google. Let's go to business.google.com. Because I've already set mine up, it looks a little different, but here's what I'm saying, that here's the various clients that I can work with. Yours, what does yours say? Say, show people, click on that, just go ahead and click on that start now button. Did you go to business.google.com?
Mm-hmm. I think I have a page on my profile.
Do you want to use this one or do you want to use another one? I would say let's create a new one just for practice so that we can see how it is. So you would be go to the address business.google.com. Business.google.com. So mine looks like this, yours might look like a map. Basically, here, these are the different clients that we have, and they've all got their own page. Again, my own personal stuff will not show up with these clients, so don't worry there. Now, it's asking you, okay, here's a map. Let's claim your business on Google Plus, but that's assuming you've got a business at an actual location. That's why it's got that map, and it's saying type in the address of your location. Now, a lot of us might not have an actual location. We work at home or from home or whatever, so we don't have an actual location. So probably what you'll want to do instead is if you click the three lines at the top left, menu, mine says, add location and then also create business account under brand pages. Is that what yours says? There's brand pages and locations.
Add a brand page.
Add a
brand page.
Okay, that's what we want. Click add a brand page. It's different for some reason. So. Add a brand page. Go ahead and click add a brand page. Okay, so let's see. Add a brand. Okay, add a brand page. Good. So before I go on, in that menu, if you notice at the bottom, it says support. And the cool thing about this is real support. This is not just a little help yourself sort of thing. This is a phone number that you can actually call for a real person at Google to help you with this. So, you know, if you're a real business here on this business.google.com page and you need real help, there is a real phone number where you can talk to a real person, and I've used it. I've been with a client at 11 p.m. at his store. We were having trouble with the Google Plus thing. We clicked on that, and we got a phone call back like in 1 minute, and then we talked to a real person, and we fixed the problem that was happening on Google Plus. So that does work there. It's really hidden, though, isn't it? It's under business.google.com, and it's in this side menu that you might not have ever thought of. And then that says support, just like I've always seen everywhere, but this is a real phone support. So what we're doing here, add brand page, here it's saying, okay, create your Google Plus page. It's saying your page name, website, and type of page. So earlier when I showed you google.com/plus PMD Interactive, that short address, we select that short address elsewhere. This one here is the name that appears when someone searches in Google Plus. This is the name of your business. Technically, it's not unique because I could create a brand new page. Like, let's say I know that CNN has a website on Google Plus. It will let me create a brand new CNN page here. That's the nature of the system. It will let me do that. Like on Twitter. When we set up Twitter, remember we had full name and we had username. And full name could be any name that already exists. That's not unique. Username on Twitter is the unique one that only one account in the whole world can have. This is similar to that. Page name. It's like that full name. Any name can be typed here and it'll say, great, welcome CNN. But on a future screen is where I can actually select the unique username that only one person can have. So here I'm going to type in the name of my business, and I can type it as normal words and letters and put symbols in and all of that and numbers and even emoji. I can put emoji here.
Yes. Is there a benefit to being descriptive such that saying DUI and criminal defense in San Diego? Does that help search engine at all?
This little piece here won't be as valuable as the other things we'll be doing. It is important for you to put in an accurate name for yourself here, and you could throw in, you know, one little keyword and such, but I wouldn't focus too much on filling that in with keywords and such. We're going to do that on other screens. So here's the name of my business. And if you've got a website, you should put in your website there, because the point of all of this social media is get followers, get a captive audience. But still, most likely, I'm going to sell my product or get my donations or whatever on my website. I'm still going to need people, lead people back to my website. You've got a few options to choose from here. Are you a product? Is it about entertainment, community, other? Whichever one is fine, whichever one fits. I'll just select other. And then there's the terms and services that you need to agree to. If you want to read it, you can click there, but you need to agree to it or you can't use it. Go ahead and create page. Now, it might ask you for an account verification. That's going to be a phone number where it'll send you a text message. And the point of that is that it's going to let you verify that you're a real person, not a spammer.
So skip the tour?
Yes, you can skip the tour for the moment.
My page.
Oh, okay, because you've already got a page, so it just took you back to your original page. Okay. Let me just catch up with you guys. Mine's a little different. Now, at the moment, Google Plus is going through a rebranding, and there's a new design on Google Plus. I personally don't like the new design too much. I've been using Google Plus since the beginning, 2011, and I really like it personally. I also like it for business. And they've recently changed their design a little bit, and I don't quite like it. But I'm going to live with it because eventually they're going to upgrade everyone's account to the new design, and we might as well use the new design. So what I'm saying is, if anywhere on the screen it says something about meet them in Google Plus, it may be at the top, it may be in the corner. If anywhere you see try new Google Plus, go ahead and click on it, just so we're all looking at the same thing. So I'm going to click on that, try a new Google Plus. If you don't see it,
let's see, somewhere. Give me somewhere, let's try this. Click on the three on the lines, click on home. This is the familiar design. Click on the three lines again. And this time go over to Google Plus page.
Could you set this up like you do Google AdWords for a certain geographical area? Can you set Google Plus up like that?
Or so, like to target it to certain areas?
Yes.
Not exactly. You still need to couple it with AdWords to really reach the specific audience.
Gotcha.
Let's check over here for a moment. When you're here, go ahead and put that background right there. And if you should do it. And if you do have the new Google Plus, go ahead and put the three lines right here on this page. Let's go. And now put the back arrow on the top right. All the same place right there.
All right, so let me go back. What you guys should be seeing. Something like that. Okay, so see how this menu, you may or may not have the menu on the left side. If you don't see it, it's because you just have to open the three-line menu right there. But if you open that three-line menu, this is the basic different screens of Google Plus. Mine's a smaller monitor, so mine might hide, but yours will probably show because you've got larger screens. But if you just kind of scroll down a little bit, you may or may not see what some of the things that I'm seeing. That's okay, but you're going to see here, okay, this reminds me a little of Twitter, or it reminds me a little bit of Facebook, or it reminds me a little of Pinterest. All of these social networks are different versions of the same sort of concept, a social network. For regular people usage, it's sharing the latest cat pictures and chatting with each other and all of that. For business, it's to reach an audience that might be interested in my products. So what I like about Google Plus is that it has, like I said, collections and communities, which give you a great way for you to be found on Google Plus. On the left menu, you have home. If you click home, it always takes you back here to this main home screen where you can share something.
How do you get there, Al? I'm still in business, so how do I, let's see, how am I doing that?
Is this the business you want to manage?
No, this is it. I'm done, though.
Click on the three lines there, and click, okay, that's just click on the manage.
So here on the home screen is where whatever we post would show up. If our page is following other pages, we'll see their stuff. So again, we've got followers and following, like Twitter. We're going to see that on Instagram. We're going to see that on Facebook. They've all got following, followers. They've all got posts. You can share text, video, links, whatever. So whatever you did on Twitter, you can basically also do it in Google+. You say, well, okay, if I do it on Twitter, why do I need for Google+? The answer is that there's so many different people on all of these networks that these are potential different audiences that you could reach. Perhaps whatever you post, you could post the exact same thing on Twitter and Google+, and it might reach more people on Twitter, it might reach more people on Google+. You don't know. It behooves you to try both. They're both free. They both do have paid aspects of them, but the free stuff should work really well. And Google Plus has collections and communities. So click on collections to see what that's about. Collections is sort of like Google's version of Pinterest. I don't remember if we're going to be talking about Pinterest in this class. I have to double check the syllabus. But with this screen, which is reminiscent of Pinterest, it's basically going to be a variety of, you know, a variety of graphics in little squares in topics. Pinterest has these topics that people can follow. And so here, I went to collections, and you should see you've got featured, following, and yours. Just to make sure we're all in the right place, everyone should be under featured. I think that's what it should show you by default. And what featured is, it's showing Luke Robluski is sharing about mobile design and data. Danny van der Merwe is sharing about open source software. Tina Vicek is sharing about Tina's cooking. So different people or companies are sharing stuff on a topic in Google+. And so I found the topics of these people, of what I might be interested in, like landscapes, and I can click follow. You don't have to follow any of these, but it might be interesting. So I'm seeing this stuff, and I'm interested in this. I'll follow that. I'll follow this. I'll follow that. The point of that is I'm going to start to see their stuff on my home screen. Think about it the opposite way. What if I create collections of content that is interesting, and then people come here to the featured and see my collections and follow my stuff? I'm sharing my logos that I design. Let's say I'm a web design company, and I'm sharing the logos that I've designed. I made a little collection here called Logos, and someone sees it and follows. What if I make a collection called Posters, and I share the posters? So people are following my content. And the point of all of this social media is to share stuff to entice people to click your link, to buy your product, to donate to you, to read your article, whatever, whatever your purpose is. And so Google really pushes now collections. Share stuff, but organize it into collections so that people can choose to follow what they're interested in. Look at that, this person right here, Blog Brands, this company is sharing SEO content and social media. I might want to follow that to see what are they sharing, what can I learn? You don't have to click follow, but what you can do is click the thumbnail of the collection. Try that. Click the thumbnail of the collection to see what it has. Let's see what this guy. The psychology of color and its importance in marketing. Ooh, that might be useful for me. I might learn something. What else? Three ways to analyze Facebook video performance. LinkedIn research reveals why your employees' voice matters in social. So someone is sharing all these great tips on social media and such, that'd be great. I want to click follow. If you don't see this collection that I see, you do have search at the top. Let's say you don't see that collection, and I type at the top, SEO tips. Just press enter there. Then this will pop up here, collections or communities or whatever, with that keyword, and I want to see more. So all of these people are sharing stuff about SEO, or cats, or Photoshop, or whatever. So I've got search, and this is searching Google Plus, and I'm seeing all this stuff, and I might say, great, I'm going to follow everything. I don't recommend just to blindly follow everything. I do recommend that you take a quick look. Let's see if Eli Fennell really knows what they're talking about. I'm going to click on that link there and see, okay, I'm reading this. When was it published? 1 week ago? 7 weeks ago? 5 weeks ago? Maybe these articles are interesting. I will follow. It is useful for you as a business to follow collections on Google Plus because this is inspiration. These are tips and advice. If you see people doing a good job with this, if you see people commenting on this stuff, if you see people liking it, these numbers right here are likes. If you see that someone is doing something right, you can learn from that. What are they doing and how can I do it? Over on Twitter, remember we had that little heart. We can give a heart, which is a like. Over on Facebook, I can give a like. It's the thumbs up. On Google Plus, I also can give a like, but they call it a plus one. Do you see everything that's being shared has a little plus one next to it? And maybe a number. This one's got plus one 40 times. Someone clicked like on that 40 times. That one seems to have been a good post. This one's got 48 plus ones. This one's got 29, maybe this one's got one, maybe two or whatever. Let's say I'm gonna search for Photoshop tips. People are gonna put collections out there about Photoshop. Which are the good ones? I don't know until I click to view and then I can follow. I would not follow just because a result appears. I would actually check out the collection.
Is there any kind of like social proof ranking? You know how like the WordPress plugins, there's like their amount of positive reviews or amount of downloads. Is there anything that would indicate to you from a bird's eye view like this that they're worth following?
I wish that they would include the stats of the collection on this screen here. You don't see the stats until you click the collection and they're here on the left. My social worth indicator would be how many do they have followers already? Because if they've got 7 followers, either it hasn't really been discovered or it's not very good content. This has got 465 followers, so I wish they would show those stats on the bird's eye view up here, but you still have to go in and explore them yourself. When we talk about communities, we do have something about that, which we'll get to in a moment.
Okay, so I see this, they have this one travel one here, right? Could I post a question for this travel?
Now, here's the thing. With collections, the short answer is no.
Okay.
With collections, someone shares something and you can comment on their thing if they allow the comment. But when we get to communities, we'll be able to do what you're talking about.
If you post something and somebody comments something you don't like, you can remove it?
Yes. Google Plus gives you that ability, unlike Twitter, where if someone replies to your tweet negatively, you can't do anything about it except block them, and that's only that you will not see them anymore. On Google Plus, if someone comments negatively on your thing, there's a little button, delete it. And you can do it. It's your content. We'll see that in a moment. But I want to go back to the top level here, wherever you're at. Let's go back to the three lines, and let's go back to collections. Collections. It was showing featured. If you're following any collections, they'll show up there under following. If you no longer want to follow a collection, you can go to following and then you can click the collection and then you'll have unfollow. And then we've got a third column of yours. These are your collections. If you go to yours, here's where you'll have the button create a collection. So this is where let's try this for a moment. We can delete these, of course. But let's look at yours. Let's click on create a collection. It wants a name, visibility, and a tagline. So let's say here I'm doing a collection full of classic tech. I'm going to share pictures and links and videos about classic technology. Let's say this client is about, you know, technology, web design, and so forth. So I want to share, something about technology. There's the option of visibility. Once set, it can't be changed. We're going to see in Google Plus that we can share our content very targeted, in that I can share something on Google Plus specifically to certain people, specifically to certain groups. Whereas on Twitter, I tweet something and everyone sees it, or no one sees it. But on Google Plus, we can target our shares much more directly for free. So the first question here is, okay, would you like everyone to on Google Plus to possibly be able to see it? When we did that search, that was all public stuff. We have different ways to share, which will make more sense as we move forward. We're going to talk about what are circles. Then we've got only you, so it's like a private collection. Only you can see it. But notice it says if you set it to only you, you cannot change it later. So you have to do have to plan this at this point. Custom, don't worry about that just yet. I highly recommend this should be set to public. Yes?
Can you select which circle you want to show it?
Yes, under custom, this will list all your circles when we talk about circles, and we can target it to them.
Okay, so if I create a collection, this is, when I give it a name, everyone's going to see the name of it?
If people search, if someone searches up there for classic tech, they might see my collection, yes. This will be public, yes.
So I better put something, my goal is to get clients, so I want to put something that they're going to search for.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, but I wouldn't put in a huge sentence, because notice you've got a spot here to write a quick name for it, and then you've got a space for a tagline. In that tagline, you then have 80 characters to put a little bit more detail. And then it's also going to be the content of the collection that people can find. So the title of this collection of mine is Classic Tech, and then under tagline I'm going to write here a collection of old and interesting computer memorabilia.
How many do you follow?
How many collections am I following?
Yeah.
Not a whole lot, because I actually like communities better, which we'll get to soon.
No.
But this does have a value.
I'm having a hard time thinking about describing the collection.
This can be edited as many times as we want later, but what's your name at the collection at the moment?
It's Dr. Drunk.
No, it's DUI and Criminal Defense.
I would think about being specific. Like, remember, you wrote a few blog posts that were specific. Think about it in these terms. Even though it's not a blog post, think about it being a little bit more specific. What aspect of that would people search for? And we'll, and then we'll...
Consequences of...
I would think legal consequences. Legal consequences is the top name of it, and then the detail of it would be, in the tagline, be a little more specific there. Consequences of DUIs and so forth. Now remember, you're going to be sharing stuff here specifically on that topic, so will you be able to share, you know, 3, 5, 10 different things on that one topic? 1, 2, 3, 5 different things. If not, that's okay. We'll
still change the name?
Yeah. That can be changed. Yes. So here's, I'm building this collection. I'm going to click Create. Then we can do a little bit of branding for it. We can choose a picture. I won't worry about that yet, but I can go in and change a picture. If you click there, you can choose different pictures, your own picture, patterns, and such. You can choose a general color for the collection. Not a whole lot to choose from, but different colors to choose from. Visible to public, yes. People that have you in circles automatically follow this collection. Again, we'll talk about what circles are exactly a little bit later, but that's basically followers. When someone circles you, they've followed you. So it's their terminology. They circled you. They followed you. Twitter calls it, you've been followed. Google Plus calls it, you've been circled. And vice versa. If you follow an account, you have circled an account. So this is just saying, if someone follows your main account, they will also automatically follow all your collections. That's fine. I do want that. If you don't want anyone to follow this collection and really explicitly follow it, you'd have to turn it off. But this default is fine.
So that would be something that you would select if you feel this particular collection is representative of, like, the people who follow you, that they know you by that, right? Let's say, for example, if I'm an underwater basket weaver, but that's a very weird thing, right? And I only select a few of my friends know that I do that, and I care very little to advertise that, then I would leave that off. But however, if I normally am a daredevil or something, and everyone knows that I'm a daredevil,
Everyone knows that you're Matt Murdock. Yes, go on.
Exactly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like that, right? It's like I'm kind of known for this. So if they're following me, they wouldn't be surprised.
Exactly, because this business is all about technology. So I'm going to be creating a variety of collections about technology. Therefore, there should not be surprise that if they follow my main account, they'll follow all these different things about technology. But if I'm very eclectic, and if I create one about this and one about that, and they don't relate, I might want to turn that off so that they can specifically choose to follow the collections. Yes?
So we're going to make a collection, and the collection is going to be like a collection of posts?
Yes, exactly. It's like a folder.
Our own material.
Your own material, yeah. It's going to be like a folder to organize your different posts.
Basically, it's a blog.
Not quite.
Articles.
No, it's just a folder. It's a folder to collect all of the different things you're sharing, which could be videos or links or text and so forth.
I can see the power of this because sometimes you're like on Twitter and you're like, oh, I want to post this. You're like, nah, my Twitter account is more business related. That's personal.
Yeah.
Or like, oh, I'm going to put this on Facebook. Wait, let me put this on my Facebook business page. Or fan page.
Yeah.
Because you kind of have to make distinctions based on what face you're putting forward.
Yeah, and that's going back to that previous assignment about our market strategy and company profile. In there was that question about who's your target audience. And we should have a target audience. We should be focusing on a particular audience. If we're going to do a variety of things, then we're diluting our message. So this is a great way then to focus our message into collections. I'm going to click Save, and now it moves me over here. I'm in this collection. There's nothing here yet. So on the bottom right corner, I have a little pencil. Sometimes you see the pencil, which is to add a new post, and sometimes you see it at the top where it says, you know, what are you up to? Both of those are the same thing, to add something, but here I'm adding something in a collection. And just to check this out, if you click the pencil, it's just like Twitter, like Facebook, like all the networks. Type something or add a photo. And here I'm not limited like on Twitter. Twitter I can attach 4 photos. Here I can attach 40 photos if I want. It'll make a little album about it.
How do you get to that?
You click the pencil on the button. We can attach a link. That's cool because if you copy a link from your blog and paste it here, it'll automatically create a little thumbnail and take a little bit of a snippet of your blog post and help you fill this in. You can attach a location also.
When it says 8 followers, that's of that collection?
Of that collection.
Already?
Yeah, what happened was this automatically, because I left that check mark on, it also automatically, the other followers just followed this already.
I didn't know that was on. I thought it was on.
Because it was colorized, it was on. When if it's gray, it's off. If I attach a location, this is not useful for everyone, but let's say if I attach a location and I've got a business, if I actually have a business on Main Street, and I'm sharing something such as sale this Saturday, and a great picture or whatever, and I attach a location. That location there will then let people find it on their GPS, on their phone, get directions and such. So not everyone needs that because not everyone has a physical location. But adding the location there is useful if your business is about that. So I'm about to share something on this for this company to this collection, and that's the symbol for collection. That little diamond shape.
So on this, I'm supposed to give this a title, like a subtitle, because a lot of things are going to go under this collection. 5 or 10 different posts will go under this.
Under that collection.
Your classic tech.
Exactly. So let's say here, one of the things I'm going to share to this collection, let's say I would start off with some text. Maybe I do want to write here a couple paragraphs, a mini blog post. I could add a blog post to this collection. I could add a photo, etc. So I've got some place to write. And I don't have a limit here. I don't have a limit like on Twitter where I've got 140 characters. I can write as much as I want here. So I could write a full 500 text blog post if I want, but who's going to want to read a wall of text?
Does it just do the read more?
Yeah, there'll be a little snippet, a little read more, and then you can read the rest. So I don't recommend that you do the huge blog post here. I still recommend that you have a little snippet so that then they can go back to your blog. Let me show you this. Let's say I go to my company's blog, pmdinteractive.com/blog. And I want to share this article about Peach. So if I copy that link, and I'm here sharing it as a link, this is what I'm saying, that it'll create a little, an automatic little preview. It takes the picture from the article, a little blurb here, and then I can write something else about it, such as check out this great article about this new social network, and post it. So that gets added to my collection. The followers of that collection would see it. They might get intrigued by enough of that and then click to go back to the main article. I can, you know, further write stuff here. And then people go back to the main article here. So still really, most of the time, 98% of the time, you're going to share stuff to these social networks. And you're often going to share some link somehow back to your website, because on my website is where they can watch the video, read the article, buy the product, hire me, etc. So look at the competition, how they're always sharing stuff, but often with a link back to the main content. Yes?
Good question. So would you need, would you do UTM tracking for analytics, or just because it's coming from Google, it'll automatically take care of the source? You know what I mean?
Because it is so integrated, Google Plus and Google Analytics and so forth, it does kind of mark it on its own. If you really want, you know, very, very specific,
like naming, whatever.
Yeah, you can create those dimensions in Google Analytics, sure. But by itself, without any extra special help, when we log into Google Analytics, it will show you under your acquisition screen what you got, the traffic you got from Twitter and Google Plus. If you want the exact posts and such, then you might want to finagle it a little bit more. But, you know, this is good for most people. So let's say I was going to share this. Do you know how to use the latest social network? Educate yourself. You have the ability here in Google Plus actually to do a little bit of basic formatting. We can do a little bold italics also. That's different. I can't do that on Twitter, really. I can't do that on Facebook. Here, I can easily add some emphasis with bold and italics. The only trick is that you won't see the result until you post it. So let me write it like this. Asterisks is bold. If you wrap asterisks, which is Shift-8, if you wrap asterisks around words or sentences, that will become bold once you push post.
That's the Google Plus rule, or you just made that rule?
That's the Google Plus rule.
Well, it just, you know, emphasis,
because when you're the 800-pound gorilla, you can make it up. underscores are italics. If you put underscores around a word or a sentence or a paragraph or whatever, after you post these, this will become italicized. And there's one more which is not that useful at all, but you might want to use it, I guess. If you do dashes, is strike through.
You would think that underscore means underline.
Yeah. They don't want to do underline because when you put a link, a link is often underlined.
So this is a Google Plus markup language?
This is a very basic markup language, yeah. A very basic formatting. Markdown. So you won't see the result until you post, but let's say in my text up here, I wanted to emphasize, you know, the latest social network. I can make that bold because everyone is sharing text or pictures or whatever, but few people know that you can do this. I'm sure it's somewhere in the help file, somewhere, and I don't remember how I discovered it, but not everyone knows how to do this bolding in italics. So if you're doing it and everyone else isn't, yours is going to stand out. That's the point of it. That's the point of this emphasis, to stand out. So let's see what it looks like. I'm going to click post, and after I post it, it'll render it. Look at that. Asterisks become bold, underscores become italics, and dashes become striped. Meaning very not too useful, but maybe I could think about it in contracts and the law and such. You strike out an old statute. Or maybe, let's say you wrote something a month ago and you've got new information. You can go back and edit your posts, unlike Twitter, because you can't edit your tweets anymore. You can go back to your posts and edit them again. If you click on the date,
of your post, you can go back to edit them whenever you want. And let's say a month later, I changed my mind on something. So I could delete it, or I could dash it out just to show that's what it used to say, and now this is what it now says.
So I don't really get a lot of use out of dashes. I use the asterisks or the underscores a good amount because they do stand out. But you don't want to overuse them because then they lose their emphasis.
Can you do the emoticons on the
same? Emoji?
Emoji.
Yeah. So, you know, I can do the plain old emoticons. But I can go over to getemoji.com.
Oh, and it'll support the tools.
Yeah, there you go, getemoji.com. And I can get this one. I can get the little deal with it emoji.
Oh, so are there definitions? Do you know what these emoticons mean?
Yeah, they technically do have a name. I believe you can get them from here, actually.
So does that box mean that your browser doesn't...
Exactly. Yeah, whatever this guy is, probably the little one with the little hand like this. Not all of them get it yet. But the definition of these guys... you can get them all from here somewhere. Emoji. Grinning face, drooling face, unamused face. So right there, this one right here, it's also known as the unimpressed emoji, the dissatisfied emoji, or the unamused. Yeah, exactly. There's a very basic definition, but the Apple one is the most famous one. This version you see all the time. And you've got the Google version of it, which is this little blob thing. The Microsoft one's pretty simple. And then Samsung does their own version, and Twitter does its own version, so this is kind of annoying. They're all rendering it slightly differently. There's the Twitter one. So like the wedding one.
They're all vectors, or is it like SVGs, or...
They're fonts. They do treat it as fonts, actually. This one looks really weird. The Google one. That's the classic Apple one. But yeah, all of these are selectable, copy and pastable, and you can put them into your posts, even over on Twitter. Twitter renders theirs a little different. There's some weird ones that really change.
They're becoming more culturally and racially diverse.
Yeah.
That's funny.
This one's funny right here. So the woman with bunny ears Apple shows it as two girls in leotards dancing with bunny ears, and then Google as one character, and everyone else like that, so they all render it slightly different. So yeah, I can also share text and links. So
that's based on the people that receive the message or that look at the message.
Yes.
What kind of device they are.
Exactly, because this one, if it shows here, if I see this on a Microsoft device, it's going to look like that. A girl with those pink ears. But if someone sees the same message on their Motorola, Google.
It's not on the device that wrote the message.
Exactly. It's based on who reads the message. The receiver. So the same one is going to look like this. For the Apple people, it's going to be the one that they're used to of the two girls. And for the Google people, it'll look like their little weird blob thing with hair. And then if you share it on Twitter, oh, this one's cute. If you share it on Twitter, then it's going to look like more like the Apple one, although a little weirder. And if on Facebook, they've got their version of it. So. And then there's the open source version, which is Emoji 1. All right, so this is collections. It's basically folders to organize your posts. The value of this is that when people are on Google Plus and they visit the collections screen featured, your collection may be featured here. Now, the downside, of course, is that hundreds of millions of people use Google Plus. And I can create 30 collections, and someone else can create two. So my collection might show up more than the other person because there's just more of them. So collections are cool, and Google is really promoting collections nowadays. But I'm going to show you instead a much more effective way to use it. Any questions so far, though?
Is there a limit to collections?
I don't think so. I think you can divide it into as many as you want, and it's a good idea to specialize, because then you'll reach the audience that you really want to reach.
Mm-hmm. Is that the collections the only kind of answer to Google for like dividing business and personal, kind of like a personal page or?
No, actually, you missed it before you got here. You do have to create an actual different one. So, on the top right corner here, I am using my business account here. There's my personal one.
Oh, I see. So you have to make a business.
Okay. Highly recommend. The business pages have the different abilities that the personal one doesn't, because it's business. So up on the top right corner, if you click on that, you'll probably see your personal one, and there should be a button to create a business one. You can create as many as you want.
So on mine, the business one shows up at the very first, just like yours.
Yeah, because we switched. We remember we logged in and then we went over to the business.google.com and then we switched to it. So that's what mine has as well. When I first logged in, it showed my personal. But then we went to business.google.com and switched over, and now I'm using this business. And now I can switch to that business if I click on it, or that business if I click on it. Each one is separate from every other one. This doesn't mix with that one, because that client doesn't want their stuff mixed with that other client. We can use one email account, one Gmail, to manage as many business accounts as we want, basically. Very similar to Facebook when we get to that.
Question.
Yes.
In this case, you have a different business under your account.
Mm-hmm.
What happens when one of those business change the person that handles the kind of service?
There's a setting somewhere. Here we go. Setting. Under settings, you have manage. Then you can set the managers. I have a contract with those businesses. Therefore, I'm working on their businesses. But let's say our contract expires. So then I would need to go over here, settings of the page, and change the managerial positions. Remove myself as a manager and give it to someone else. Multiple people can manage one business. Therefore, one person can remove another person, but there's the ability for multiple people to manage one
page. So that
page
was created under your profile, business profile.
Mm-hmm.
Then the contract expires, another company is going to handle that account. Just move it over to their company?
Yes, basically. Here I can go over to manage, and then there's a button down here, top here, managers. So then up here, I can add more managers. So I'm going to add the new managers of the business. Once they're approved, then they will show up here, and then they will remove me, and then I'm out of that. So I can add multiple managers and give people access or remove access. Mm-hmm.
So I can put my own picture on this post.
Yes. Definitely. All right, so let's say we've been looking at collections. They're valuable, but let me show you the even more valuable thing. This is so much better because this assumes that someone stumbles into it. You know, every time I go back here, it's a different amount of collections because there's hundreds of millions of people using this, and it's showing them randomly all the time. You're not going to see the same ones often. So here's a much better way that I like to use Google Plus. And I've done, you know, personal tests where I share the exact same thing on all the big networks, the Google Plus and Twitter and Facebook, and I often see the most results come from Google Plus if we do it the way that I'm about to show you here with communities. Communities are like collections in that it focuses on a specific topic, your IT professionals, SEO, whatever. But now the big difference is that different people can contribute to the community. Whereas a collection, only I myself create the collection and other people can look at it and follow it, but they can't contribute to it. A community is like the old message boards where people where people can all congregate together on a topic and collaborate. Because right now, I have zero followers. I just made this account. No one knows I exist. I have zero followers. But if I go to the graphic design community and join it, I can post something here and 186,000 people will see it. 186,000 people that care about that topic. I can go over to the Apple community where 500,000 people are congregating. And if I share there, 500,000 people will see that. I have zero followers, but I can still reach 500,000 people. Now, don't click join on these yet, because my rules for this are try to join communities with at least 1,000 people. All of these that it's recommending for me, there's a lot of good good communities with a lot of people. Good. But let's say you don't find a community you're looking for here. Let's say I'm this bakery. I have search on the top again, and let's say I want to search on top here for cookies. I want to find any communities about cookies. It showed me collections results, and it's showing me cookies results. So I want to see more communities with my keyword. Let's see what it gives me. Cakes and Bakes, Sweets and Treats, 71,000 members. Down here, Chocolate, 41,000. G Plus Sweets, 24,000. Cookie Connection on Google Plus, 661. So it really ranges. These communities are made by the people of Google Plus and run by the people. Actually, these communities are made by the users of Google Plus and run by the users of Google Plus. They're not made by the official Google company. They're not run by the official Google company. Someone got an idea to create a community called G Plus Suites and got 24,000 people to join. And the reason I say that is because all of these communities have their own set of rules. So again, I wouldn't simply join just because it's at least 1,000 members. I would still click to view the community. I clicked on that one. All these communities are going to have some sort of description, and you are highly encouraged to view the description because oftentimes they will say what is allowed and what is not. So someone created this community and it says sweets and more sweets. Welcome to our food community. Learn all about baking and dessert making and enjoy mouth watering. This one is pretty open. Oh, here we go. About community rules. Place post in appropriate category. Share no more than one link from your website a day unless you are participating in the special hashtag event. There's also a second rule, number two. It must be very important. Again, regular people are creating this, not the official Google Plus people. Here it says, do not merely drop a link. Include description. So someone created this community, or a group of people created the community, and they've got rules. So if you follow the rules of the community, you'll have a good time. You'll share something. You might get followers. You might get replies. You might get likes. You might get sales. If you go against the rules, you might get kicked out of the community, worst case scenario. And I just lost access to 24,000 people. And there's nothing you can do about it if you get kicked out. If they kick you out, they kick you out. There's very little that you can do about, oh, I'm sorry, please let me back in. If there's a tyrant ruling that community, there's a tyrant ruling that community. You can't complain to Google. I have. I've been kicked out of a community I like. And I thought I was running it really well. But this person kicked me out, and I can't get back into it. The end.
So this is the graphical version of the bulletin board?
Yeah, exactly. You can think about it as bulletin boards. People all over the world coming together to share something on a certain topic. And someone manages it to keep the good stuff in and leave the bad stuff out. Yes?
Now I noticed, and I think I just figured it out, the 2D on the upper right-hand corner of each community means last post 2 days ago?
Yes. It might say 2 days ago, 1 hour ago, 10 seconds ago. That's the date, that's the timestamp of the particular content share.
So if the community hasn't posted anything in about a year,
yes, that's my other rule that I was going to get to. You want to have a community with a good amount of people, at least 1,000, and you also want to then check out the community. How active is it? If no one has added anything in 2 weeks, then whatever you're going to share, no one's going to see. You may have 5,000 members, but no one has shared anything in 2 weeks, no one's going to see your thing. That's why simply don't join just because you see a big old join button. Click on the community. Read the rules, see how active people have shared, how recently they've shared.
So would you say posted at least what? At least,
well, it's up to you, but I would say if it's like, you know, more than a month before anyone's posted, I think that's kind of a dead community, because people use this stuff all day long, every day, and if nothing's been shared in a month, sounds like a pretty dead community.
Okay, I believe you, but if you post to it, then it'll say posted 1 hour ago, and then maybe somebody will read your post or not.
Maybe it could get the ball rolling. When activity starts, it could get activity started again, and then it may die down again, or it may keep going. There's nothing wrong with trying it. This is all free. Try it, and it may work out for you. It's just that in my experience, I have seen that, you know, when a community kind of falls by the wayside, it doesn't quite come back too easily.
That means nobody in the community is using it, so you have to rely on a new user to see it and want to.
Yeah, and that'd be an uphill battle, maybe.
Is there any such thing as, like, invitation only?
Yes, some of these communities will say, ask to join.
Oh.
So on that one, if I wanted to, this is a relatively small one, but what if it's passionate 2,700 people? They're not going to let me. I will be able to click to see what everyone's talking about here, but I cannot join it and start posting until I click that button, and then someone's going to go visit my profile and see, what are they about? They're not about this topic, so we won't let them join. Or they'll see your profile and collections, and they'll say, oh, they are about sweets and stuff. Let's let them join. Question?
Yes. Back to the last time something was posted.
Mm-hmm.
When you do a search, are they listed by the... I can't tell. It almost seemed like it's not really going by the last time somebody posted to it. I'm wondering how they rank it to put the first ones on top.
It should be relatively recent, although it kind of does jumble it, because I searched here cookies, and then it said 5 hours ago, 13 hours ago, 9 hours ago, 10 hours ago. It does jumble it up around a little bit. I'm not exactly sure how they order it, but you'll always be able to see it in the corner there, how old it is.
I guess the point is that you're going to... you may as well search through that whole page to figure out if there's anything good at the bottom. You can't just go by the top because it's not the same.
Yes, thing. Browse it around a little bit and see how old things are. But then the next piece that I was going to say is, okay, let's say people have been posting on a regular basis. Have there been any reactions? Because all of these posts, just like Twitter, have the ability to like, which is the lowest level. They have the ability to reshare, which is another level up. And they have the ability to comment, which is a higher level. So all of these posts have the same thing. This one right here of creamy cookies for Mother's Day, it's got 10 plus 1. So it's got some activity. This one here had 3. If I keep going down, let's see what else. This one's got 10 and 12 and 22. So there is activity. People are giving the plus 1. But again, that's the minimal amount of effort. I can plus 1 something and move on. The next level up is someone clicked this share button. They saw this and they wanted to share it to more people because it was so good. This has got 2 shares. This one's got 2 shares. A few of them had no shares. No shares on that one 5 weeks ago. No shares on that one. It did have 15 plus ones, but again, that's the easy one. Click like and move on. This
you
one
may be able to post something, but it may appear at the bottom of the page.
I don't think it'll go that far down. I think it does try to put it in some kind of order early on, but it seems that when we view it here, it does jumble it up a little bit. The next thing, the next level of effort is the comment. So right here, Leanne Radcliffe wrote, they look great. And then I saw another one, thank you, and yummy. So this one has then the next higher level of activity where people actually take time to write something, even just one word. But this particular post was a big hit. It's got some good amount of plus ones and shares and comments. So here again, look at communities of at least 1,000. See that their posts are not that old, and see that people are active, because there could be many communities that are full of spam. The people, spammers, are just posting stuff every day, and it looks like, yeah, this is new. It was posted 2 hours ago. But no one is replying. No one is commenting, and therefore your stuff is going to get lost there also. I'm going to go back to communities.
What about creating a community?
I don't recommend it, because now you are going to need to get people into your community. You're going to need to kick out the bad stuff. You're going to need to be a moderator. And I don't want to do that. I just want to be part of a community that I know is already in good hands. But yes, you have the ability right there. Go to yours and create any communities you want. I don't recommend it, because now that's more work.
What would you recommend, let's say, cutting your teeth in this experience in like LinkedIn first, creating a group there? Because I keep hearing that LinkedIn, like, one of the keys to success is creating a group. Well, first being a part of a group, and then once you grow up to be a big boy, you can create your own. But I don't know. Because you're right, this seems like a big mamma jamma. Like, there's a whole bunch of people.
Yeah.
And I would think that would be more burden than what it's worth. But if you had great results of seeing LinkedIn and have a vibrant community,
but that doesn't mean that community will grow also on this network or even follow you over. So every network's a little different, but the short answer is try it. Give it a shot and see how it works. If you did get good experience on LinkedIn, try it in Google Plus, and it might work out. I honestly, though, believe don't reinvent the wheel. There's already a lot of great communities here. You can be a part of it, join it, and be a part of it, and become an active part, and that's going to be good enough, because then people will know you and follow you and all of that. Where now you're trying to build a foundation from the beginning with a brand new community with no followers, might not be worth it.
Would having pretty popular collections that are followed frequently kind of...
Yeah, that's the thing also. That's also the thing about social media. Popularity breeds popularity. So when you've got a lot of followers, that's going to help your collections, and those collections are going to help your communities, and those communities are going to help other communities. So the more popular you are, the more popular you get. But you have to start somewhere. All of these started with one member, the person that invented it. And now the Android community has 1.7 million members.
It almost sounds like a really big step, huh?
It's a big, really big step, but it's the one that I highly recommend you dive into, and it'll be part of the homework, actually. When we do the homework for Google+, get into communities and start using them. you just have to, you know, be careful and follow these rules and check the rules, literally check the rules of the community. If they say do not post spec work here, don't put it. Best case scenario, a moderator tells you, oh honey, this shouldn't be here, and then they remove it. Next level up is they remove it for you, no questions asked. Worst level, they kick you out. And then now you've lost access to a million users in that community. And like I said, for myself, I've been kicked out of a community. And you know me, I'm a good guy. Why would anyone kick me out? But I was because one of my hobbies is, you know, Comic-Con and comic books and all of that. And I was sharing some of my Comic-Con photos to a community about cosplay, which is, you know, costumes. But the particular tyrant running that community was only really interested in certain kinds of cosplay. And I had posted too many times the kind that he didn't like. And guess what? I'm not in the community anymore. And I have no one to complain to. There is a community here somewhere about Google Help. What do they call it? Google Small Business. There is a help community here. Google Help. Let's see that. There should be a community. Google Help. Yeah, there we go. Thank you for that. So if you search Google Help, this is a community from Google Plus where you get real answers from the moderators of Google. And I went there and I did some screenshots and I said to the Google Help community, hey, I've joined this community and I follow the rules and here's what I've shared. And this guy kicked me out. What can we do about it? And he said, sorry, we have no control over these Google Plus communities except for content violations, so sorry. So they will not get you back into a community just because there's some tyrant running it. If that community is posting spam and wares and viruses and all that, maybe they'll get involved. But if simply someone's a jerk and runs it like a jerk, can't do anything about it. Make your own community. Like I said, don't make your own community.
Do you have any communities that you recommend?
Yeah, definitely. It depends on what you're trying to do online, but I definitely recommend the Google Help community. Get on that one because you can get a lot of great info and help there. Google Plus Help. I also recommend, depending on your business, I like the Google Small Business community. And I, for my business stuff, I like this SEO community.
Wait, where'd you find those?
They might appear randomly under recommended, and if they don't, you can search them. But this SEO Plus community with 205,000, that's one. And the Google Small Business with 896,000. Those are two big ones I recommend. And then besides that, you know, in my web design business, I'm in this web developers community and this IT professionals community. So again, these ones with a lot of users are very valuable because now my Google Plus page that I just created with one follower, now when I post to this Google Art Projects community, I reached 500,000. If I follow the rules. And there is a certain point where I would say the opposite. Too many members. These million member communities, 800,000 members and such, those are also have a detriment in that there's so many people sharing stuff, you're gonna get lost. Your posts then are gonna get pushed down by all the other people that are sharing stuff. So if you go under 1,000, there might not be enough people to sustain. If you go over, like, let's say 800,000 or so, that might be too many people, you get lost. Now, I break that rule all the time, and I am a member of the Android community, and it does work. It's got nearly 2 million people, but I do post Android-related stuff there, and it does get action. It does get likes and clicks and all of that stuff. So even these big communities have a value, but it's very fleeting because there's just so much going on in them.
So for me, I need to figure out communities just in San Diego since I practice only in San Diego.
Unfortunately, there is a limitation there. There is, unless the community itself has itself listed with that keyword, you really can't target those communities. So you can try doing search on top there and put that keyword of San Diego and see if any local San Diego stuff does show up. It's probably going to be pretty limited, but then you can maybe join a few that seem promising. So there's communities about everything. Join as many as you want. Follow the rules. Some of them will say no cross-posting, meaning I joined two web design communities and I post the same thing to both. One or the other might have a rule that says no cross-posting, meaning don't put the same thing on multiple communities. And yes, there are people that run these communities, these moderators that have nothing to do all day long except be on Google+. So they're going to go look to see that you're following the rules. And you could get, you know, best case scenario, they tell you. Worst case scenario, you're kicked out.
Okay. Sorry for all the questions.
No, that's okay.
So I did a search for San Diego, and then San Diego Padres comes up.
That seems more not a community. That might be an actual profile.
Okay. Let's see. It might be because it doesn't have...
Yeah, you see how it's divided into communities and it's divided into collections. So click more under collections, and then it should show you more of collections or more communities. Then it'll focus. So it really depends on what you're trying to do online, but there's going to be plenty of communities with a lot of people.
So I might end up joining some sort of lowrider or car club.
Yeah, sure.
I'm not into cars. I'm trying to market myself.
Yeah.
Am I going to get kicked out for
no
information about DUIs and having nothing to do with cars, or do I have to camouflage it and pretend I like cars?
To some degree, you do want to read the rules. Let's say here, okay, I'm on the Marvel community. I wouldn't dare post anything about DC. But let's say that I am at a community about cars, and you don't have to be a big car fan, but you are posting something to people that are car enthusiasts and might have drunk and driven. So you have to read the rules and see, okay, what's allowed on this community? Don't post this, don't post that. And if you share something, just very blatant advertisement that say, hey, everyone, I'm a DUI attorney, that might not go well with the community. But maybe if you share a photo of a great hot rod and say, don't throw this away with a DUI, then you put your link in addition to your photo, that might fly. But again, read the rules and see what's allowed. Yep.
How do you find, like, let's say the official, like you mentioned Google earlier, like, I don't know, I was looking for a couple other ones, and how do I find the official, because I was looking at who the owner was. I went to Apple, for example, and it was just some random dude.
Yeah, unfortunately, there's no official communities, really. Anyone can...
There's a lot of almost like repeats, too.
Yes, definitely.
Like a lot of Me Toos.
Because someone had the idea, I can do it, and I can do it better. Yeah. They're not doing it. So there's no official communities. There are official profiles and such. So try to look to see if any of the moderators and such, you see that one's marked as a moderator right here, Landry Levy is marked as a moderator. So some of these might have marked as a moderator, or they might have like a check mark that says they're an official representative and such. So this is the thing. It's the good and bad about it is that it's very open. You know, the good thing is that anyone can create a community, but the bad thing is that anyone can create a community. So you just have to do a little research and see if it's the right place for you. There's
so
often
monetize Google Plus at all yet.
Nope, they don't need to. There's no ads on Google Plus because they get all their money from when you search on Google Plus and spying on you. No, I mean when you people do their AdWords and all of that. So they can lose money on this to some degree because they're making their money on the Google business and the AdWords and all of that. So we won't see any ads here except for those that we post ourselves. Whereas we're going to get all these ads and promoted tweets on Twitter and promoted content on Facebook and now Instagram and Pinterest. But for the moment, we're safe from those kinds of intrusive ads on Google+. Any general questions? And then we'll go look at the homework. So the screen's a little different, the terminology a little different, but in short, it's just another social network like Twitter. You can use this and post onto it every day. You can search hashtags and keywords. You can follow and be followed. Following is simply let's say Tristan here, I want to follow Tristan. You know, you can click on their profile, it'll go to their profile, and there's a big old follow button. Easy. If I then want to unfollow them later, I can go look at the people screen, and this is everyone that I have followed, everyone who's followed me, and suggestions.
So there's no automatic, like, reciprocal?
No, exactly. It's like Twitter in that it's one to many. One account can be followed by many, whereas Facebook, traditionally, it's one to one. One person did a friend request to another person, and it's reciprocal. Here, it's one to many. One account can be followed by 20 people, but you don't have to follow back all those 20 people. So that's the people screen here, the circles, following, followers, find people. When you follow accounts, then you can put them into circles, which is their term for a way to organize people. So in my example here, let's say I'm a pet shop, and I'm going to share something about cat food. Well, some of my customers are cat people, some of them are dog people, some of them are bird people. The dog people wouldn't care about that post about cat food. So I can share specifically to the cat people circle, and only they will see it. This is sort of like a mini junior version of communities. You can share to these direct connections that you have in circles. But still, I think it's a lot more effective to use communities because it's many more people of a specific topic.
Are the circles, labels, line, the members of that circle?
Nope, the members will not see what you call these circles. They will not see if you add that person into the annoying people circle.
Yeah.
They won't know. They'll just have the notification that says, you know, Victor's Bakery added you to a circle. Or Victor's Bakery followed you. And on the top right corner is where we get our notifications. If any activity happens, it shows up there.
And I can add anyone to a circle as long as I follow them?
That is the same thing. It's pretty synonymous. The terminology is a little weird, but once you follow someone, you're adding them to a circle. You have to choose which circle. For example, just simply the following circle. If I find someone, let's just say,
I guess for the sake of like avoiding spam or whatever, like say some very loud person in the sense that they market a lot and almost in an annoying way. Someone can go in, follow me, add me to a circle. Well, by following me, add me to a circle, and then send a bunch of promotional material my way.
They could, in theory, yes. So. I don't see that too often, actually. I think Google is doing a good job about that. But in theory, that could happen. Someone could, you know, follow you to send a lot of spam your way. But I really don't see it.
Yeah, kind of like you said, say you're a pet shop and you find a really effective way to target dog people. And you got this dog brand stuff. And all of a sudden, you start following a bunch of people. They never heard of you. Don't care about you. But you're following them. You put them in a dog circle. And all of a sudden, hey, you try my new dog food. And you're like, dude, who is this cat?
Yeah. That could happen, definitely. I don't see it too much. So thankfully, I guess the algorithm works really well. So it's worked pretty well. But the person always has the opportunity then, when they're getting annoyed, click the button there to block, and then you're done. What was that? Free samples. Give that free cat food sample to their dog. Yeah.
Will you be notified if someone blocks you?
No.
So, it seems hard to
me. Well, it's just a different kind of way of doing a very similar thing about following, followers, and sharing. It's just that we're focusing on communities here, which the closest thing about communities in Twitter is the hashtag. But that's a big chaotic thing. I tag something with a hashtag, and now everyone on that topic is sort of linked together. Here, it's much more direct. I go to a community about a hashtag, a topic, and I post there, and everyone in that community sees it.
Okay, I wasn't here for the Twitter. I have to mark. We have to create followers. We have to get followers, right?
It's not part of the homework. Followers is a perk, but if you check the homework, it's simply posting. You have
Should
to post stuff.
Should we all follow each other to start off?
No, that wasn't a requirement of the class.
Does that help at all?
No, because you guys don't care about each other's businesses.
I don't know. I mean, actually, I've never been drunk before.
I mean, if I follow you and then eventually one of my friends follow me and they see that I'm following him.
That could help, sure, definitely.
I think on a grander scale, that might be more relevant, but a group of 10 people, I don't know how it would
work. Yeah, the sample sizes is a little small. If we had 30 people, even that would be a little small. But there is a value to getting, you know, real people following you and such, but really, are you going to be able to build your business on a small group of people? No, that's why you're going to be over here on these communities or using hashtags to find a larger audience. So let's watch the video and you'll see. Let's take a quick look over at the homework assignment for this social network. Let's go over to Blackboard. It won't be as hardcore as the Twitter one.
Well, yeah, with the Twitter one, I put, sometimes I posted like a 1201 or whatever. I was like hurrying up. I'm like, oh, man. So it counted as like two on the same day.
It probably will get you like a D plus. Don't worry.
There you go. Five above a D.
Let's take a quick look at the homework then in our class. The sixth assignment is here. Google Plus.
I'm glad you covered Google Plus, but no one ever does.
Yeah, and unfortunately, there's a big stigma behind.
Horrible.
Everyone is always like, Google Plus is extinct, and it's dumb and dead, and all. I just showed you a million users on that.
Yeah.
500,000 on this one, 200,000 on that one. It's the people, the naysayers are always comparing it to Facebook. Everything's a failure compared to Facebook. Instagram's a failure. Twitter's a failure. Pinterest is a failure. LinkedIn's a failure. Everything's a failure.
MySpace.
MySpace is a failure compared to Facebook.
Is this still
around? It's still around, yeah. Jason,
good for music or something.
It's good for music, and Justin Timberlake owns a stake in it, so let's help him out. But everything's a failure according to the metric of Facebook, because Facebook's got 1.5 billion users. And your mom uses it, and your grandma, everyone uses it. It's a success, great success. But Google Plus has hundreds of millions of users. Twitter has hundreds of millions. Pinterest has hundreds of millions. They've all got a lot of users, special demographics, and so forth. And so I like Google Plus. I've used it since day one in 2011, and it does work for the clients. It's just that the trick is communities. If you're not using communities, then yeah, it's going to fail for you. It's going to be a ghost town because you don't know the secret. Go to where the people are at, communities on Google+. So for the actual homework, you need to make sure you've created an account on Google+, like we did together, business account, and then go in and fill in your profile and such. We didn't do it together, but you can figure it out. Add your profile photo and bio and such, because who's going to want to follow an empty blank account? That's what a spammer is. You want to have your picture there or logo, you want to have your biography, whatever lets you fill it in. Because if you're trying to join communities that say ask to join, why would they let in a half-created account? You're then going to send me an email with your Google address, and your Google address, you will find it basically if you go back to home, it's going to be this big gibberish address there. Because you're a brand new user, it's not going to let you have a nice, simple name yet. That's one way they prevent the spam. You cannot claim the short name until you've used Google+, I think for a couple of weeks, and actually posted stuff and been active. Then one day you're going to log in, and at the top it says, would you like to claim your custom name? Then you'll be able to get a nice short name like google.com/plus PMD Interactive. But I didn't have that. Our company didn't have that on day one. We had to set up the profile, use the profile a couple of weeks, use it legitimately, and Google then one day said, would you like your custom name? So for you, for the homework, just go back to your home screen. Whatever address that is up there, whatever gibberish address that is up there, that's your address. Send that to me so I know where your account is. Then
I'm on Google Classic right now. I mean, the old one.
Yeah.
And I think it only shows it on the profile.
Yeah, so wherever it's at. And I do recommend go over to the new Google. Eventually, they're going to turn off the old Google.
Yeah,
you might as well.
That, yeah, link, cause I went back. Oh, here it is. At the bottom.
So then for the actual tasks of the homework is collections. Create at least two collections. You've all probably got two collections by now, but I've been talking, or maybe one. Create two collections. And add content. I didn't say how much. It's all up to you. But create two collections
on your profile, and then go to communities, join at least two communities, and post content, whatever you want.
Again, the purpose of all of these lectures and all of this stuff is really, what are you getting out of it for the real world? Yes, you're getting an A in the class or whatever, but what are you getting out of it in the real world? So if I'm telling you, do this, this, and this, and post every day, and then you'll get your A, well, great, but hopefully you're seeing that it's because that is to challenge you to think about what you're going to post. Another link, another photo, something new, something weird, something different. Here it's a lot more lax. Two collections, two communities, share whatever. I'm not technically saying one thing for each community, you know. Define it however. Collections and communities, you may share text, links, pictures, video, whatever. You may share original content or repurposed. You can share other people's stuff, sure. But you have to decide, are you getting the most out of it by sharing someone else's? Or are you feeling more confident and legitimate if you're sharing your own stuff, your own photo of your business, not that other photo you found online? You'll be graded on your ability to set up Google Plus and complete the tasks. Nothing about followers or anything like that, just using it. And it's due 1 week from today. It's 10 points, 11 p.m. Wednesday the 13th. That's the homework. Any questions on that?
Yeah, I think there's a function that may show up like that.
Mm-hmm.
The business page, it's literally like a different kind of account.
It's attached to your main account because as soon as you log into Google Plus, you'll be in your personal account. See, there's my picture, it's my personal. And then on the top right corner, I switched to my business ones. If you don't see this kind of screen here, what we did was we went up to the web, to the address business.google.com. And we're going to do lab in a moment, and I'll give you the details. But that's where you go over to then attach a business page to your personal one.
Now, I've been using, like, I guess I created a Google account. Mm-hmm. And I've linked everything, you're like webmaster tools or whatever they call it nowadays, analytics, tag manager,
mm-hmm.
everything. I've linked it all to that one. So is there a way to, in a way, work backwards, like make a personal one and make the one I've already have fully integrated to everything that fits?
Let's look at that during the lab. Probably there is, but we'll see it in a moment. Any other general questions? Okay, I'll print that out in just a moment. All right, so that's it for the moment. We'll have some lab time for a little bit, and see you next time. I'll be doing the Twitter grading in a little bit, and we'll go on and learn more stuff. Next, if you look at the syllabus next time, I believe our YouTube lecture is coming up. That one's going to be two lectures. Part one, how to make a video for YouTube, and part two, uploading videos to YouTube, because you can't do much on YouTube without a video. So we'll spend the day on making some videos for YouTube. That'll be next time.